So welcome everybody for this second international conference for international aspects of Brazilian defense policy. This year our team, as you are very well aware, is South Atlantic Security Actors, Strategies and Interests, or Interests and Strategies in this order. Well, first of all, I would like to welcome all of you here. This second day of this conference, we started yesterday evening at the Canning House with Rear Admiral Rocha, presenting the idea of South Atlantic from the Brazilian perspective, especially the concept of Blue Amazon. And we have a long day today with many presentations, many lectures and debates, as you can see in the program here. Before we go to start exactly the talks here, I just would like to say that an activity like that is only possible when we have and we make a lot of collaborations. And that's been quite successful in this conference. For this conference today, would be not possible if we haven't had the collaboration of Canning House yesterday, Russi today, not only allowing us to use this fantastic space here, but also having some speakers during the conference today too. I would like to thank personally Ani Freitas, who collaborates with us in Brazil Institute for quite a long time, and we finally get together in a sort of more strong or meaningful activity between Russi and Brazil Institute, and Naval War College in Brazil, from the Brazilian Navy. That's a strong partner that we have too, sharing many activities together and basically trying to build up a sense of interoceanic collaboration in naval knowledge from the Brazilian point of view. I also would like to thank the three PhD students that helped a lot to make this conference possible, José Cláudio, Ludolf, and Christopher. Where is Christopher? Is there? Yeah. The three of them are here. They did a lot of work to make this conference possible to us here. What else should I say? Well, we will start with a very calm and comfortable conference in the sense. We are not in a rush here. You can see that we decided to have a model of conference that's not that 15 minutes presentation when everybody needs to run to say something and we need to pretend to say some question intelligent after that. So what we have here, it's like 2 hours for each panel with two speakers in each one. Each one of the speakers will have from 30 to 40 minutes to present their ideas, and we have enough time for a debate here. Okay, so that's I think it's a more comfortable way of doing a conference than just rush with everything at once. I just advise you that we are filming this conference, so if you don't want to be filmed, you need to disclose that for us. And we have a Wi-Fi network here. You can get the password in the end there. During the intervals, we have some food and cafe, etc., so we don't need to leave the building. Caipirinha, we can provide some cachaça by the end of the day if everybody behaves well. Yeah. But yeah, well, I again just would like to welcome you and thank you, William and Ani, for helping us to make this conference possible. And I will pass the word to Ani. Also, Vienna.
Thank you, Vinicius. Thank you all for being here today. Actually, I can only say that this is the concretization of a dream. We started last year during the first conference, and last year I joined RUSI. That's why I'm also here today, kind of representing RUSI. Last year I joined RUSI to manage, now leading a European project on maritime security. And when last year we got together for the first conference on Brazilian defense and security, and I thought, why not bringing RUSI together with the Brazilian Institute? And this year I'm really happy that this could be done. I really like to thank my colleague Peter Roberts to have joined us today. It's really a very good opportunity for us, the Brazilian Institute and RUSI, to really join forces. Since we're going to be filming this conference, I will say my disclaimer right now, because actually I'm leading a project, a European project, so today I'm going to talk about the European maritime security strategy. And of course, everything I'm going to say today is on my capacity as a researcher at the Brazilian Institute, not so much about, you know, as the leader of this project. Well, that said, I really hope this is going to be the first of a lot of very successful experiences and collaborations between WUSI, King's College, and why not, the Naval College in Brazil. Now, I give the floor to William to say some words.
Okay. Well, distinguished Professor Vinicius, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm Professor William Moreira from the Naval War College, Brazil. We are very pleased and honored to be here, and I'd like to thank the King's College Brazil Institute for organizing the second conference, as well as to thank WUSI and the other institutions that have contributed to make this event possible. This is, I would say, one more step forward in our important partnership that has been successful. To this year, we have already done some events. In March, we had a workshop in Brazil with the presence of professors from the King's, and late August, soon after the Olympic Games, we had a mini course taught by Professor Kieran Meaton, also a success that deserved the attention for our students. We have I am the coordinator of Maritime Studies postgraduate program. And the students were very happy to hear from a professor of a world first class university, right? So I bring the salutes and the compliments of our director, Admiral Silva Lima, and also from the president of the Center for Political and Strategic Studies, the Admiral Monteiro. I think the Naval War College is very pleased with this partnership, and I would like to, and Professor Beirão, we'll talk right now, and would like to thank you in advance for this event. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I just must say also that the Brazilian Navy is hosting almost every year now, already for 2 years, so I imagine that we can continue next year some study excursions to some areas of Brazil in which the Navy operates for students and staff from King's College London. And during this period, we can know more about the work of the Navy in the region. We have been last year to the Pantanal between the Brazil and Bolivia border, no? And this year we went to the Amazon and spent quite a good time there, getting to know the region and the work of the Brazilian Navy there. So this is also, I think, a way of strengthening the relations and make us know better the work of Brazilian Navy. Without more delays here, we will start the first panel of this morning, and my colleague Annie, she will chair this panel. We have just a small alteration there. We switch the order. Instead of starting with Professor, you have the correct one. Because Professor Carlos Alfaro Zaforteza, he's finishing a class and coming to here. So he will arrive a little bit late, but still in time for this first panel. So let's go for the first one. Yeah.
I don't think I need to really introduce you too much. So, André Beirão is a postgraduate program in Maritime Studies in the Naval College of Brazil, as William just said. He's going to talk today about the regional challenges to the maritime security in the South Atlantic, which is quite interesting talk. I would like to hear more about this. So, enough further ado, please go ahead, Beirão. You have 3 minutes, which is, I hope,
enough. Well done. Morning for everybody. I'm Professor André Beirão from Brazilian Naval College. As Annie said, and Professor William, who works with me, your team there in Rio, just besides the Sugarloaf. So if you want to go to Rio, you probably will pass in front of our Brazilian Neighbor College. It's a nice place to meet, you. For me, it's an honor being here. It's the second time I come here for this conference. First of all, I'd like to say all of you, I'm not an English native speaker, so maybe during the presentation I may forget some words, but I know there is a lot of people here who speaks Portuguese, and I will not be afraid to ask you, how can I say that in English? And I will continue. Language is not a problem for me. The importance for me is to show you what is my research, what I think, and what we are thinking together. So let's start. For me, it's a pleasure. And this presentation, it's a continuing research that it's now almost finished, but it's not enough. I have to do a little bit more. And I began doing this research for June this year, when we had a meeting hosted by Brazilian Naval College and Rio with the International Maritime Organization to think about maritime security in South Atlantic. And I've done a conference there about this research, and now I'm continuing the research and I will present you. Well, first of all, like Jack the Stripper, I will cut my regional challenges to maritime security in South Atlantic. First, maritime security. How we define maritime security? Maritime security is a big conception. We can put almost everything inside it. But if we put a lot of things, we cannot define the real point threats to be aimed to achieve our objectives. So, how can I say? Well, if almost everything nowadays we have in the ocean, we say, well, it's a maritime security problem. We have to cut it to understand what are the real challenges to be faced, though. So I say, I tried to define maritime security with a topology approach. I imagine the maritime security as a concept, complex, convergent, and divergent. And I will try to explain you why there are three different approaches for maritime security. Why maritime security is complex? We have a lot of gears working together. Some of them are bigger, another one smaller. But we have universal friends, faces to 70% of the Earth surface, our seas. We have regional or multilateral perspectives, thinking about the seas nearby them, the problems focused by regional problems, have national interests in about the seas in front of them, their resources, their security problems, hard core of security problems, and we have included the interstate features. When we see some institutions or oil companies, MODs, some coast guards, so internal institutions looking by their views, their point of views. So we have different ways looking for the same problem from maritime security. So that's why I say it's complex, because we can see from the universal trends to interstational, interstate futures. Why I say it's convergent? Because we can put inside maritime security a lot of trends, universal trends. The first of all, universal peace. Of course, if we are looking forward to universal peace, we have to have our oceans with peace. The natural linkage, link between all countries. The good order at sea as a good enough thinking for using peaceful the world, using peaceful the seas. We have the concept of freedom of navigation since Grotius, talking about we have to move where we want. Seas are not a mare clausum for anybody. We have the maritime safety as a part of maritime security, because we have a lot of subjects in maritime safety, the mines in maritime security, and the opposite too. And you have the sustainable use of the sea. So you have a lot of different points of view converging to maritime security, from big ones to small ones, but all are converging into maritime security. And why I say it's a divergent concept? Because if you think, well done, this is the hardcore for maritime security, we have some issues indeed inside this core, but some of the other issues are a little bit far, a little bit far, and a little bit far. But they are maritime security subjects too. And I continued this research from the beginning of the paper with my colleague Christian Berger from Cardiff University, and I define maritime security, I try to use these four quadrants. From human security perspective, economic use of the sea, environment, and national security. These four quadrants, we can put some subjects sometimes more close to the center and sometimes fast. Here I can put some thinking. Well, all of these problems are maritime security problems, but some of them are a little bit far from the center. If you are in more environmental thinking, marine pollution, climate change, exploitation of resources are maritime security. If you look by a national security perspective, interstate conflicts. We have not a lot of interstate conflicts in sea nowadays, but it's a problem. Terrorism, weapons trafficking, and Corso, well, we can say, oh, it's far. Okay, it's over. But we still see some states financing some works in the sea that we can say, well, it's almost a Corso, but it's not exactly the real concept, the classic concept of Corso. If you look for a human security perspectives, you have drugs trafficking, human trafficking, slaves trafficking. If you look for the economic use of the sea, you have piracy, smuggling, including exploitations. So where I put each one of these subjects more closer from the center and more far from the center, it's different depending of each point of view. That's why I started thinking, well, if I want to think about South Atlantic perspective for maritime security, we have to look for this and other points from South Atlantic perspective, not from world universal peace perspective or eastbound's perspectives. First, like I said, like Jack, the second part of my title is South Atlantic. So I have to think, well, South Atlantic, it's not an Atlantic Ocean. It's a different ocean, South Atlantic, from North Atlantic. I have to think about this. Of course, in terms of a seas, all of them are together. We have just one sea for everybody. It's a freedom of navigation for everybody. But we have to see, well, there are some special things that we can define this as a geopolitical different area, the South Atlantic. So I start looking for a geopolitical point of view. If you see here, we are looking from military power, from naval powers, perspectives, from the countries. And as you can see, the world map is not as we are accustomed to see. If we look for maritime power perspectives, under the Ecuador, where are our big countries? We are not seeing that in this. All of them are above the Ecuador. So, of course, the neighbors in the north are accustomed to see one for each other from a different perspective and a different point of view from the south. So south, it's not a military region as we will see this. And if we look for the south flank from a social, economic, and cultural point of view, you will see again a completely difference between south and north. We cannot see blue areas under the Ecuador. Just purple, reds, and yellows. So poor countries with identity from colonies. Words, it's a different world. Sometimes ago, we would say the third world is under the Ecuador. Nowadays, it's not good saying that. So we can say, well, they are growing up faster from the north, but we know they are very far from the north in a social and economic perspective. And they have a cultural identity completely different from the north. Normally, their minds are, there are somebody wanting to explore in us. They are thinking all the time about it, mainly in Africa. So they want to change this, and sometimes with an aggressive perspective. Well, you have to pay now if you want to be here. It's a cultural problem. If we see from maritime strategy, well, it's different, the South Atlantic from the North. This is a shipping traffic routes. And if you look for the North, you may see it's almost a corridor from East to West. And we can say, well, North Atlantic are dangerous area. But it's easier to be controlled. Because if you have a corridor, you have to say, well, they are leaving from here and they have to achieve that point. And leaving from there, going to here, it's a corridor. It's easy to be controlled. But if you look for the South Atlantic, instead of a lot of less traffic, you may see you cannot define a route, a corridor. We have going from America to Africa, from the South Africa to United States, crossing the Atlantic, from South America going to Europe, crossing in another way. So you have a lot of entrances, a lot of different corridors, so it's completely different to see this region from a maritime security perspective from the north. So we can end the yellow points that I put in this map, just in South Atlantic. We have some special points so important for resources, for countries from the south, resources in front of Angola, in front of the Gulf of Guinea, Malvinas, in front of Brazil. So a lot of choking points for resources for these countries all around the Atlantic, the South Atlantic. So we can say, well, it's a different region. We cannot say the Atlantic is just one ocean. The South Atlantic is different from the North Atlantic. That's why we have to face the challenges from their perspective, from South perspectives. Well, looking with the complex, divergent, and convergent concept of maritime security, looking for South Atlantic, I started the research. From the convergent approach, maritime security, it's an inclusive approach with the participation of several extra regional actors. A multilateral perspective, we are a region that we have a lot of extra regional actors in there, and there's no problem about it. If you see, there are some other sea areas that there are so difficult to see extra regional actors working there. If you look to the China South Sea, it's difficult to see another extra regional actors there. But in South Atlantic, we have a world convergence, a multilateral perspective working for South Atlantic. If you look from the divergent approach, as I told you, there are different subjects. Some of them are closer from the hardcore of maritime security, and other ones are far from maritime security. So we have two different dependent variables: the global interests and the other one from national interests. I have to look for that, these two perspectives, to see the intersections about their perspectives. What do they judge indeed relevant maritime security? And what have I done? So I had to face this perspective. The global interests framework, and I would like to have 24 national interests frameworks. The 24 countries from Zupacas face the two South Atlantic. But till now, I have just 16 national interest frameworks. And it was so useful for me, for my research, having that event you may see here. The event that we hosted from IMO and Brazilian Naval College, that we had 16 stakeholders from 16 different countries from Africa. And I could make an interview with each one of them, looking, well, what's your national perspective from maritime security? What are the main problem you have to face on? Probably here in the north, you may think, but piracy is a problem. This is the normal and generical point of view. Piracy is the problem. Where did I got the global interests? Looking for United Nations resolutions, declarations from General Assembly, resolutions from United Nations Security Council. If you look for some NATO speeches, and mainly about maritime security academic meetings, and looking for the subjects they are faced on in each one of their resolutions, meetings, I put it doing this, the method that I explained, the international, the global interests in this position. Piracy is the main problem, terrorism at sea, a second one, and bigger, drugs trafficking, human trafficking, in this position. And I asked for the South Atlantic countries, and asking all of them, putting all of them in the big data. Here we have the national perspectives, piracy, resources exploitations, marine pollution, terrorism. So you can see they are in the different positions. Some of them closer from the center, and some of them bigger than the others. And if you face the international trends to national trends, you have this. And if you put all of this together, look, resources exploitation in a dark gray, it's from global trends. It's not a big problem. It's a problem, but it's not a big problem. But for the countries from the region, it's a big problem. And I tried to do this, the convergent perspectives, the intersections between different points of view. And doing that, we have this framework. And if we look at that perspective, it's completely different from the first one, from global UN perspective. And why I thought it's important? Because if you want to engage a country to work together for maritime security, this country has to see that he's working for his problem, not for others' problem. And, okay, I think that's enough. And I tried, well, this is a framework for the interests from the region. And the easy way to work for maritime security is looking for some common perspectives to engage all countries to work together against. And I choose these two regions: terrorism, drugs trafficking, weapons trafficking, and piracy, smuggling, and resources exploitation. Look, interstate conflicts are so far, it's not a problem for the majority of countries of the South Atlantic. Thanks God we have a peaceful ocean there. This is the beginning of a perspective. And as we could see in that event from IMO, countries want to work for these problems, not only for piracy, but for all of these different problems. Well, we have some other reactions. What we are doing to challenge this phrase. And I will do looking for a complex approach from bottom to up. We have some interstate cooperation, institutional cooperations working, national corporations, multilateral corporations and some global corporations. And here I will just show some examples. It's not enough, but just an example. Mainly from Brazil perspective, of course, because I know it much better than the others. Here we have an example. The Brazilian Navy have a lot of bilateral agreements with a lot of African countries, South countries, looking for a system for trafficking oil activity, system for trafficking fishing boats. So a lot of bilateral agreements facing for their problems, resources, exploitations. If you look from the national perspectives, they are growing a lot. We have a lot by lot bilateral agreements growing continuously in the region. Brazil, Namibia, South Africa, Argentina, a lot of agreements growing in the region. If you look for some multilateral corporations, they are growing too in the region. We can see here the coordinator of Area Maritima del Atlantico Sur, the oldest initiative of cooperative control area in maritime security. Almost 50 years working together, Brazil, Argentina, Paraguay, and Uruguay. We have the CPLP, the Portuguese language countries forum, looking for South Atlantic perspective, because two-thirds from these Portuguese languages are in South Atlantic. So it's a hard war for Portuguese speaker countries. You have the Zopacas. I was so unbelievable to Zopacas. What is that? Who is the lead? Where is the point of Zopacas? But if we see from a perspective of cooperation, keeping the South Atlantic as a Pacific, it's growing little by little, 30 years working little by little. And we cannot see it in any other part of oceans. And from a global perspective, I'm almost ending, from global initiatives, we have a lot of United Nations initiative or European Union Naval Force in Somalia, the UNFOR, Obangama Express in the Gulf of Guinea, or the Task Force 151 from the United States and other countries in Somalia. And I've put that one in Indian Ocean, and the map shows the coast of Lebanon with the Maritime Task Force leading form for United Nations as a part of UNIFIL a peacekeeping operation in Lebanon, working in the sea. So as we can see here, we have some global initiatives to maritime security, including the United Nations. That's why I do this question. Why not a United Nations maritime peacekeeping operation? If you see on the left, the charter of the United States, United Nations may work, including at the sea. It's not a star part. It's a nobody landing or nobody sees, but the United Nations work there. And if you look to the right part, the United Nations Convention of the Law of the Sea, you can see you may have ships flying the flag of the United Nations, working directly for United Nations at sea. So if we are here looking for a problem at sea, a problem that is causing world peace problems, why not United Nations can lead and leave a mandate for United Nations maritime peacekeeping operations in the region? If United Nations, with its universal vocation, aims to preserving international peace and security wherever on the globe, if the UNCLOS under United Nations umbrella, also virtually universal, foresees the possibility of United Nations itself to lead action at sea, if there is international clamor for action to mitigate risks to maritime security as expressed, for example, in the United Nations Security Council resolution calling for effective action in South Atlantic, and if the United Nations most used operational tool to mitigate threats to international peace and security is the establishment of peacekeeping operations, why not? It's a new point of view. Well, it's the last one. So, we have new partnerships based on cooperation and mutual trust. We are focused on problems that the region sees as problems building a direct local cooperation. And we have new solutions to new challenges. Thanks a lot, and I'm here to discuss with you my research. It was a great pleasure for me being here. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Professor Carlos. So I'll give the floor to Professor Carlos Alfaro Zaforteza, who is professor at King's College. He's going to talk about Latin America. So it's not only about Brazil anymore, it's broader than this. It's bringing our neighbors in Latin America, talking about their own perspectives on the South Atlantic. Please, Professor, you have the floor.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a pleasure and an honor to be here with you. My apologies, because I have to juggle this presentation with my teaching commitments, so I can't participate as actively as I would have liked in the debates, and I won't be able to refer to the past presentations of fellow presenters. What I'm going to talk about is basically some brief remarks about
discover where the devil lives in that machines.
So I will concentrate on just a brief aspect of security and the struggle for natural resources. Especially, I will talk about the two major actors in the South Atlantic, local actors such as Argentina and Brazil. So it's about the future, or the, which is now beginning, competition for resources. It's about also the UNCLOS. There have been, as you know, there have been recently two rulings, one between China and the Philippines, and the other one between Argentina and the United Kingdom. Both have been disregarded. So it's something in doubt what will be the future of UNCLOS. And I will go directly to see how the main, these main actors play their foreign policy, and what is their defense policy, and what are their means, and if they can achieve their ends. Well, as Dr. Beirão said, we have to look at the South Atlantic, because we, well, at least in my case, tend to be Eurocentric and no, don't look at this too much at this part of the map. So what we are looking at is, well, basically the two big countries here, and also, you know, and these here. And we'll see that that Brazil is doing now, well, for some years it has been doing a diplomatic offensive to gain influence and collaborate with several African countries. These two maps are official. So I'm not, that doesn't mean that I agree or disagree with them, but they are official. It's about the zones by UNCLOS. Obviously, the one by the Brazilian Navy is practically not controversial. You will see that the one with the zones by Argentina is controversial, because probably the British government wouldn't subscribe to it. But this is the main scenario we're talking about today. I will first first address the nature of the threat, or the threat, whether there is a threat and how imminent it is. I then will look briefly at the foreign policy of Argentina, Brazil. Then we'll look at their defense policy. We'll look briefly at the functions of Navy, of their respective navies, and whether they have support to conduct these policies. Well, we are in a similar or parallel period. If you remember, at the end of the 19th century, there was the great game to acquire colonies. Now we are in a similar movement by especially the great powers to acquire natural resources on the seabed. And this, well, the most blatant example is what's happening in the South China Sea, as all of you know. And of course, we have the recent ruling by the Court of the Hague that has been disregarded. This, what does this tell us? That's probably in a near future, we will have some kind of new standoffs in which perhaps might is right. Well, there are basically three types of natural resources which feature in this struggle. This is oil and gas, seabed minerals, and fisheries. The most imminently threatened ones is fisheries, because fisheries are already being depleted. Then oil, I will concentrate on the measures to protect current or planned oil rigs and oil reserves. And seabed minerals is something which requires a much more sophisticated and costly technology and is part of the medium or long-term exploitation of the oceans. We have the Golden Triangle. there are very large reserves within this area, which stems from the fact that in prehistoric times these two continents were united. Now separate, but if there is oil on one side, tends to be oil on the other side. And it has quite a bright future. Actually, 56% of the drilling ships and platforms which are now in operation around the world are working in that precise area. In particular, the Brazil's polygon has reserves of about 175 billion barrels. This is Brazil's polygon, which is made up of the Batia de Santos and basically Batia de Campos, and is one of the main objectives of protection of the Brazilian government. This is the oil rigs and oil exploitations in the Falklands Islands, that, as you know, this is claimed by Argentina and is, of course, a source of conflict or potential source of conflict. The threat, and this is one which is actual, is overfishing by foreign actors, external author actors of the Patagonian coast. The Patagonian coast is very rich in fish, especially squid, and there are more about 4,000 Chinese, mainly Chinese vessels, also some Spanish ones, which just hover around the limit, and when there are no Argentine vessels, they just go inside and try to fish whatever they can. Of course, most of this goes unreported, and the Argentine Navy, especially the Argentine, has actually captured in the last 15 years about 69 ships, and some of them have been sunk by gunfire. This is the same map. I we have seen before, but there you can see that the region is about here. So they hoover, the fleets, the fishing fleets hoover around here, and they come in here, and then they take shelter into the Falklands territorial area. Because there are basically not enough ships in the Argentine Coast Guard. You see, the South Atlantic, of course, this is a minor part within this which takes place, especially around the Gulf of Guinea. But the important thing to know about the Chinese fishing, because you know it's the first fishing fleet in the world, is that they actually fish about capture about 12 times more than what they report. They actually report. I'm going now to look at briefly at the policies of the main actors. This is a brief comparative. We see why Brazil is aspiring to be a regional power, or is already a regional power, and how the difference, tremendous difference with Argentina. Argentina, as you will know, used to be about 60 years ago, used to be the most powerful country in Latin America, and through decades of misrule, is now has become quite a weak country. See, the defense spending numbers are absolutely telling. Well, with these statistics, obviously Brazil is the leading power in the South Atlantic, and it seeks to increase its influence in the other on the other side of the South Atlantic, to be the leader of a kind of coalition which aims to, well, ideally to keep out external powers, but this is obviously not possible, but to balance these foreign powers. And for external powers, we are basically talking about the United States, the United Kingdom, China, and Russia. This is to be achieved through a mixture of military muscle and diplomacy. Well, Argentine foreign policy now has fortunately changed, and it's not that with the change in the presidency, it still used to assert its legitimate and imprescriptible sovereignty as a claim, and also to the Antarctica. As you know, most of the territory Argentina claims in Antarctica is also claimed by Britain. President Macri is now less confrontational, and he's aspiring. His policies tend to create a country which is more at peace, promote democracy and free trade. The common aims of Brazil and Argentina are, well, to exploit the natural resources of the area, especially those which are inside their own areas and economic, exclusive economic zone, to protect the reserves and keep foreign powers as far as possible out. Particular aims, well, in the case of Argentina, is overfishing, the claims of the sovereignty of the Falklands and Sandwich and South Georgia and the Antarctica. Brazil, it's about oil and seabed resources. So there would be no collaboration, but there isn't rivalry either. Well, Argentine military capability is almost non-existent by now. We have, in particular, the Argentine Navy is made up of absolutely obsolete, neglected vessels. Personnel has very low morale, so it's almost inexistent as a fighting force. It has no credibility at all. Although Macri is bent on giving it some funds to restore it, not in a confrontational way, but just to make it a kind of viable force, at least for patrolling its areas of influence. There's no public support because the Argentine populations are concerned about other issues. And of course, there is the general mistrust of the military as it exists also in Brazil because of past dictatorships and past history. Brazilian defense policy shows quite a different picture. I think it's been quite successful attempt to be independent from foreign suppliers. This is usually done by not relying on supplies from the United States, for example, which would place political conditions on their use. And they are relying quite a lot on French material and technology, and also an important part of Brazilian developed technology, native technology. In this context of the South Atlantic, of course, the main service is the Navy. And there is an ambitious program to increase it. The basic functions of the Brazilian Navy, well, there's the internal security and state building, which is a constant. Then the maritime policy is being much increased because of the new developments in the newly discovered oil reserves and the extended exclusive economic zone, and also the extension of the continental shelf. Then there is diplomacy. This diplomacy is important because of this coalition of the South Atlantic. Especially there are programs of training with some of the West African navies, and also, of course, showing the flag. And then there is deterrence, about deterring some external authors with sophisticated naval material from taking certain actions. And this, we will see that it's going to be achieved through the acquisition of high performance submarines. There is PROSU, is a program of four advanced conventional type submarines They are from the based on the French Scorpène type, and one nuclear submarine. That's the beginning of the construction of a fleet of nuclear submarines. As you know, nuclear submarines are quite much more powerful and much more mobile than conventional submarines. So the first four would operate in relatively shallow waters, and the later the nuclear submarines would operate in the deep sea. That will confer the Brazilian government with a considerable deterrent force. There is also a program to acquire surface ships, namely four frigates of about 6,000 tons displacement. That means ships able to do sustained operations on the high seas, five oceanic patrol boats, and one replenishment ship. So this is the blueprint for a high seas force. Of course, there is also the refit of the carrier Sao Paulo. As you may know, it was a former French aircraft carrier, which is still in quite good shape. And there is also the project for acquiring two new aircraft carriers. It is hoped that the progressive exploitation of all these oil resources will yield the additional income to finance the acquisition of these new aircraft carriers, and of course keep them operational, and by the aircraft company, of course, which is also quite costly. So we see Brazilian naval policy, it's quite ambitious, although the country is now in the midst of an economic depression, but it's progressing, it's basically progressing. The first of the conventional submarines is scheduled to enter service in 2018, I think. You know better than myself. Public support is, as you know, in parliamentary democracies, is a key element. And I couldn't finish my paper without mentioning it. At present, the armed forces are no priority of the present government. So the present government regards the armed forces just as as part of all other government expenditures, and if there is lots of money, they will spend lots of money on the armed forces. But if the government is not in a very good economic position, it won't spend money on the armed forces. The focus is, as has been for many years, on territorial development, which there is still a lot to do, and there is a signal of this was the new capital came from Rio de Janeiro, which was by the Atlantic, to Brasilia, which is in the middle of the continent. That speaks volumes about the mindset of Brazilian policymakers. There is also a demand for inter. Okay. And then the Brazilian Navy has launched the campaign of Amazonia Sul, which is a campaign to make people aware of the importance of the maritime dimension of Brazil, which is obviously much increased with all the discovery of these immense oil reserves. To conclude, well, the actual threat to these oil reserves is not immediate, although in medium or long term we don't know about this, because we know that future wars will be resource wars. There is a lot of literature on this, but almost everybody agrees about this as a major cause for future wars. It's by now undoubted that Brazil is the regional power in the South Atlantic, and that it will need this military muscle, because as I have mentioned, well, UNCLOS, it's apparently not well regarded. Of course, these are the first rulings, but you know, if something begins not very well, it doesn't be well. So have to be prepared to use the two tools, which are on one part military muscle and on the other diplomacy. And I think they are doing quite well in using this combination. Thank you very much.
It's interesting because your presentation was very complementary to the one given by André, because he started talking about how complex, I mean, he analyzed the complex of maritime security from a South Atlantic perspective, and you just talked about how the two regional powers, Brazil, not so much now, I understand, Argentina, see their interests and what they can do or what they can reasonably do in the region. I'm actually not making much more comments, because I really like you to pose your questions, comments, or even react to the presentation. So we still have half an hour. Please, the floor is yours, if you want to. Anyone?
I have a question. My name is Edwards. I'm with the King's Brazil Institute, master's student. I have a question regarding the Falklands. What is Britain doing to assert its sovereignty over the islands against Argentine encroachment?
Well, as far as I know, I'm not a specialist in the topic, but as far as I know, the Argentines don't do much apart from, you know, it's more about it's basically about rhetoric. You know, now there is a very well equipped base in Mount Plain or something like that. Mount Pleasant, which is very well equipped, and there are also permanently 2-3 ships from the Royal Navy, so the Falklands are quite well defended, and in the present circumstances in which Argentina is, there is neither Argentina at present has neither the capability nor the will to effectively challenge British sovereignty.
But do you think that if more spending is given over to the military, do you think, especially as you said, that future wars may be to resource wars, do you think Argentina may start to push through to Falklands, South Georgia, Sandwich Islands?
In the future, most likely, because you know Argentina is now like this, but we don't know we don't know in 10 or 15 years' time who will be at the helm. So, you know, it's over the, you know, the medium or long term, who knows, it could well be.
May I please interject, because I'll be talking about this later as well, and just before lunch I really don't want to eat my own sandwiches by contributing to things I'm going to talk about later, because they'll be made to the end later. But, so please hang around, and it basically talking about the same things, but from a different perspective.
Yes, my question is mainly about Brazil's, so Brazil building up the military muscle at a time when the budgetary situation is not exactly very positive. So how is actually Brazil planning to convince its population, or how are the politicians planning to convince the population that it is important to invest into all these military programs? And also, given that there's quite a lot of focus on the CISFRONT program and on the army programs for the land border, so how is, within the context of the of defense in the country, how is the Navy planning to get all the resources required for such capital invest intensive programs as, for example, the aircraft carriers?
Well, for the moment, the Navy is concentrated on the submarines and some surface ships. So the carriers is something which comes in the future, because of course they couldn't sell the whole this whole program. So they are concentrating on just on some parts, because what they need now for these new oil reserves and all this, they need basically patrol ships, which are not particularly costly vessels.
Mm-hmm. Maybe they don't need to also to say something about how Brazil may be trying to convince or publicize a little bit the importance of.
Again, we have to see from different perspectives. From the North perspective, it's so important to have the population convinced about this need. From South perspective, some years ago, population will understand we need that. Nowadays, they are changing their minds, thinking more about the convention of the population, like the North. And it's not easy, because we don't have the same level of our population to understand problems. So, about 20, 40, 50 years ago, the heads were not thinking about what does the population think about it. Nowadays they are thinking about it. And the difficult is to define how population will say yes or no. Normally in North countries, by parliament. The parliament is the democratic representation from the population. So the parliament will say yes or no. But from South, it's not so easy to see the parliament as the voice of the population. So some countries, I'm not saying exactly about Brazil, from South perspective. In a lot of countries, they have to see the population at the street to understand. Well, that's what the population wants, not what the parliament say the population is. And till this moment, the population was not worried about military power. Nowadays, a little bit more, mainly about public security problems.
And besides the public security problems, they are now understanding we have to have funding for a new maritime power. And I think it will not be so difficult to show the population we have to have more military power. 10 years ago, I would say to you, well, it will be difficult. Nowadays, I don't think so. It will be easier.
I find it fascinating that you're saying that it's easier because from a North perspective, especially from the perspective of Europe, with all the security issues that are currently taking place and how difficult it is to actually convince the population that there's a need for an increase in defense spending, that then when we look, when you're speaking about Brazil, which hasn't had these types of existential crises as, or existential threats that Europe has had, that you're saying that it's not going to be that difficult to convince the population, while the population over here, that in the last couple of generations has experienced major wars, is not willing to increase the budget. So I'm just wondering whether maybe there are some lessons that should be learned by the government over here to
knowing that it's not necessarily very democratic way of thinking about defense and military, because by the end of the day, the population doesn't really pay attention, also because it's never has never been an issue before.
Yes.
Should not be forgotten that Brazil was under military rule for long years, and it was not something that was brought to the public as a public affair. You know, like it should not necessarily the public, but the people should decide. So it was not in the political culture in Brazil. But at the same time,
there is a very important aspect to be taken into consideration. I think it's actually this understanding of why armed forces are for. So when we look from this North perspective, this idea of external threat, it's much more strong than when we look, especially in the Brazilian case. So the understanding of the population that armed forces are not only for defending the country from external threat, but actually sometimes to do social work inside the country, that changes a lot, the perception of the population. So one important point is, defense policy will never be an issue of discussion in a public election in Brazil. So for presidential election, no candidate will come saying, that's my project for defense, external defense for Brazil. That will not get votes. At the same time, the understanding of why we still have armed forces, that will make an important role into the population. Just a curious aspect about that, the understanding of how this the population will accept expenditure with armed forces. It's important to remember that it was published, I think 1 week ago, a survey by the Fundação Getúlio Vargas, and they publish that constantly every year about institutions and trust. So which institutions Brazilian trust more? And again, in the top of the line are the armed forces. So there is this strange combination of, okay, we don't understand very well what they are doing, but we trust them. And in this case, if we have expenditure with defense, that will in some certain way be justifiable. So I think this is a very different perspective from South and North, especially in Brazilian case, of the role of armed forces and the national budget for that.
Thank you. I think there are two things at play here. There's one, the experiment maybe of the creation of a strategic culture within Brazil, which is inherently maritime facing, which is obviously according to the Brazilian Navy, but how much is that influencing a wider understanding? Leading into that wider understanding within maybe the Brazilian franchise, getting spending on certain things like OPV surface fleet, well, yeah, that's for defending oil installations, an incredibly important part of the Brazilian economy. How does that understanding then translate into something like an SSN, which is very much an aspect of sea denial, and the question I keep on asking is, well, denying who? Mm-hmm. Out of that, then how hard is it itself for something like an aircraft carrier program, which is very much about force projection mm-hmm. at reach and distance? Mm-hmm. Is this a staged approach, is it a phased approach, or is it just all wrapped up within the concept?
Well, it's not so difficult to answer your question, but it's difficult. I agree with you, it's difficult to understand. Well, Brazilian Navy, and from Brazilian perspective, protecting the ocean is not protecting just oil and gas platforms. And when you see, well, to protect oil and gas platforms, you need OPV and you need petrol vessels. And they are cheaper, easier to build. You may build a lot of them with less financials than a nuclear submarine or a carrier. But we are blue seas, ocean, navies. If you want, first of all, our oil and glass and gas platform are not nearby coast. They are about 200 miles from the coast, 550 miles from the coast, so enough far from the coast. And we have a big ocean in front of us. So, and the main financial project is for a blue navy, for a far navy, for deterrence, and to protect the brown waters. And nowadays, the Congress, Parliament, and including the executive power, they are understanding that we have to spend, how can I say, you have to spend a lot of money for few things, and after that, it will be easier to spend less money for a lot of things, but you have to do this first. For 40 years, we are doing the opposite, spending less money for a lot of things, and now we have to spend a lot of money for a few things. I think it's a new perspective to defend the Brazil waters from far to close.
Can I say?
Yeah, of course.
Well, I would like to say that there is one of the main reasons why navies have always been built, not strictly military or diplomatic, but it's prestige. And if you are a big country and powerful country, you have to come to have the, you know, armed forces which are in consonance with this. And of course, navies are, you know, they come very well in the news, and you can show them around, and it's an instrument of prestige, and in this sense it's a very powerful and very useful, whether for hard power or for soft power. So I think the two aircraft carriers in this context, they make a lot of sense, and especially within to intervene in an area, you know, but which includes obviously West Africa.
There is a dimension of showing off.
Oh yes, it has always been all states do that.
Mm-hmm. Any other question? Please,
yeah. I'm Kai Yoshikawa, I'm a student in Spanish, Portuguese, Latin American studies. I got interested in illegal fishing in Patagonia. I think especially Chinese ships have some ports to drop in before going to South Atlantic, but does Argentine government have some relationships with other countries to cope with the problems?
So what we think
about, I think Chinese ships go to African port to get there to South Atlantic, or some port to drop in, but the Argentine government have some relations with other countries to cope with the problems, or?
Well, the Chinese fishing vessels also have an important operating base in Uruguay. And then, of course, Argentina has very good relations with China. You know, the Pampa is no longer one of the main growers of wheat. It grows now with soy, which is exported to China. So these bilateral relations are, you know, on one aspect they can be very good, and on the other, because the Argentine government is defending its natural resources, you know, can be a little bit thorny. I don't know, does this answer your question?
So actually, like, the government doesn't have a kind of strong tactics or like the strategy to cope with the illegal fishing.
No, they don't have the means. It's like South Africa. South Africa has also an immense coastline and the exclusive economic zone, but has just a few vessels to patrol, and so it cannot protect its own waters, and it's precisely the case with Argentina. They simply cannot protect them. Of course, if they had more ships and we could better patrol this, there would be probably less incidents.
But probably we can also ask if Argentina would have the political will to do it, if China being the main economic trade partner,
yes,
and investor,
yes,
do you really want to do something,
yes,
or you really would prefer not to close your eyes? Well, anyway, this is just a question.
Hi, my name is William Frost from the Brazilian Institute. I've got a question for Professor Beirão. At the speech yesterday at Canning House, Captain Rocha showed a map of the river network in Brazil and explained that this was also part of the Brazilian Navy's responsibility. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the kind of the comparison between the responsibilities in the South Atlantic and how they compare to the river networks, especially in the Amazon and San Francisco River. So I'd imagine some of the challenges are the same in terms of drug trafficking and human trafficking, but I'd imagine there are also quite different responsibilities in terms of the actual environment that sailors and ships have to navigate and negotiate. So I was wondering if you could make a comparison between the responsibilities between the river networks and between the Atlantic that the Navy has to face.
Okay, as I told you in my presentation, sometimes in Portuguese, for us, we have the privilege of having the word segurança, and we can put inside segurança safety and security. Both are translated as segurança, and it's very good, because if we want to do some security things, we are looking for segurança, and if we are faced for safety things, we are looking for segurança. And that's why, and why I'm speaking about segurança, because Navy is responsible for segurança. So you have the Brazilian Navy looking for safety and security, and they can share and mix the concepts of responsibility of security and safety. The safety zone for Brazilian Navy looking for environmental problems, marine pollutions, search and rescue,
are so big in South Atlantic. I've shown a map, including north, till 16 degrees in the north, it's a Brazilian responsible. Almost nearby the aircraft, it's a Brazilian. And as the Brazilian Navy has to keep this area in segurança, we can look all this area in safety and security perspectives. Both are segurança. So this area and is so big, and you have to have a blue water navy for an area about 150 miles far from the coast. It's not an OPV or a petrol vessel to go there. And they are working to build and to continue rebuild the Navy to keep all this area from north to south, from west to east, in segurança. All of kinds of segurança. That's why they are building this big area.
So I think there was a question, not anymore. Questions two, have a question?
Yeah.
You still have a question?
Yeah, I actually just forgot what I was going to ask, but
yeah,
go
ahead. Yeah, I just wanted to ask Professor Zaforteza a bit more about the Chinese-Argentine relations and how did that change with Macri, and especially with relation to, I know that under Kirchner's government, the Navy was planning to buy Chinese OPVs, and it seemed that there was quite an agreement that that was going to happen. And also, so what happened with all these plans to procure all the Chinese military equipment on the Argentine side, not only for the Navy, but maybe for the other, also for the other services? And another question that was actually a follow-up to what you said earlier. So how does it actually work? So the Chinese vessels come to an Argentine port where they replenish, refuel, and then they go and fish to the Argentine Sea where they're shot by the Argentine Coast Guard. That seems to be a bit counterintuitive or really a bizarre arrangement.
Yeah, yeah. No, they on the first question, I cannot answer you because I am, you know, I don't know the details enough to give a good answer. On the second question, they are based mostly in Montevideo, which is Uruguay, rather than Argentinian airports, or they also go to the Falklands.
So do the Chinese vessels also, what's the arrangement between Uruguay and China with regard, or the Chinese vessels regarding the Chinese vessels actually, do they also overfish the Uruguayan waters?
No.
No? So they only go from
no,
the Uruguayan?
No, they go somewhere and then nobody knows in principle, and then they appear where they appear. But they made a deal with the Uruguayan government, and they have an important operating base from I think it's Montevideo.
I'll give you the floor. I actually would like to pose this question now because then we're talking about the UK and the Southern Seas. And I'll be sharing with you the panel, but I would not necessarily be the best person to reply to this, so I'm asking you a question now. Argentina doesn't seem to be very well equipped at the moment, the Navy, but it still has a lot of ambitions, and as far as I can understand, maybe even if Macri is not so much about, you know, reassuring the sovereignty of Argentina, is still there because it's still
yes.
in the nationalistic
yes.
guts of the population. And it's not going to be easy for him to just give it away.
No.
So it's going to be there for a while. And what about Brazil? What is Brazilian position regarding this potential actually not potential, but this conflictual relationship between two important partners, the UK and Argentina. On the one hand, you have a strong partner, although it's not what it used to be in the past, so it's a very important economic partner, very important security partner, very important security partner in the Zapacas, in the South Atlantic, is part of the Zapacas to ensure security and to protect the South Atlantic against northern interests. But what do you do?
So easy to answer your question. But it's easy. If I answer you from official perspective, it's easy. Brazil is a friendly country with a lot of interests and a friendly relationship between Brazil and UK and Brazil and Argentina. Brazil is in the UNASUR. Officially, the UNASUR says the claims from Argentina are legitimate and they have to negotiate by diplomacy with UK, and Brazil agrees with a diplomatic solution for the problem between both. So Brazil agree with both, negotiate to a good solution for both. So easy.
Yeah, well,
but if you want to say, well, and if not, well, but if not, we will have to see who will be on this time leading Brazil, on this time leading Argentina, on this time leading US, on this time leading UK. So a lot of variables. Impossible to answer that if not. Nowadays, Brazil won to see a good negotiation between both. Just that.
Let's hope that the presidents of all these countries are going to be looking for a diplomatic solution.
Let's look for. And I think, well, you don't go to a fight when you cannot go. You have to think about it.
We have time for just two wrapping questions, so...
Yes, so my question is for Mr. Zaforteza. I was wondering what has been the historically the role of development of the role of the EU in IUU fishing in West Africa and also Argentina perhaps, but specifically West Africa, the European Union.
So can you...
What has been the development of the role of the European Union in illegal, unregulated and unreported fishing in West Africa, and perhaps also in Argentina, if that applies?
Well, I cannot tell you, give you a complete answer, but what I can tell you is that Spanish fishing companies are quite active, and in the South Atlantic, in West Africa, in many places, and sometimes are also tend to be quite predatory,
mm-hmm. including Brazilian waters.
Yeah. Probably,
yeah, in the north.
So as you can see, the IUU agreement, the EU agreement on IUU fishing, it's not necessarily very. It is effective. The share quota, that this has been quite effective in some areas, but not all areas. Especially, I say, because some countries, some of the members, internally fighting for the. To have some kind of liberty, still freedom within this regime to be able to still do to continue the activities. So there is internally in the EU a lot of political battle on the background of this agreement, because even if there has been a quite of important impact to prevent Chinese and not European fishing and taking space from European companies in West African waters, the Europeans themselves do not necessarily feel sometimes that they need to pay attention to the quotas that are imposed to them. So it's not very. So the last question.
Exercise UNITAS, which runs in Latin America on the Pacific and Atlantic side each year. The tagline of the exercise is cooperating and integrating to guarantee and secure Western Hemispheric security. Is this US Southern Command's tagline, or has that narrative entered the Brazilian Navy and the Brazilian Armed Forces' way of viewing Latin America and certainly the Atlantic?
Well, yesterday night, Admiral Rocha showed us a map with a lot of operations that Brazil do in West Africa, and with a lot of countries, mainly from European countries. Mainly Portugal, France, UK, US. Sometimes Spanish ships. And all of these operations, you have to distinguish in two kinds of operations. From a perspective of training operations for local navies, local coast guards, and welcome here, I will show you how we do that, and you, after a little time, will be able to do that. Or the other one, first one, it's a training operation. And the other one is an effective operation. From Brazilian perspective, we avoid the second kind of operation. Because we think better than operating in internal waters, including the case of some countries asking for that. A lot of African countries ask for that, please help me to operate here inside my territorial waters to avoid maritime security problems. But Brazil thinks it's better to build and to collaborate to their navies to grow and doing that in their waters than Brazilian works in their waters. Still nowadays, so we are working in a cooperation way, not in powerful and interference and operating in their countries from a different perspective from the North, mostly. The North navies was okay, let me show you how I do and I will do it for you. This is the difference between both perspectives.
Thank you, Beirão. I'm so sorry, we don't have more time to other questions now, and I think it's also important to eat, so I'll talk about myself. I'd like to thank the two speakers and the audience for being with us and for the questions. It was a very interesting debate. I think you have some
Just have like 30 minutes
for have some sandwiches and refreshments outside, and we'll be back to the second panel at 12:30. Okay?
Okay.
Thank you.